PBL Roundup. solid white line. Don't make no money if I don't make it there on time. You see Dallas, San Antonio, wind it up until I'm home. I've got 14 gifts to get you back in my arms.
Well, hi again, everybody, and welcome to the PBL Roundup Show. I'm one of your hosts, Thom Brennaman. Happy to have you with us for another inside look at not only tonight's Pioneer League baseball games, but some of the people and the places and the culture of minor league baseball, major league baseball. Tonight, obviously, starting at a new time, 5 p.m. Mountain, in order for us to give you pretty much a lead-in, like a pregame show for all the games in the Pioneer League going on tonight, and especially for our East Coast friends and fans, a chance to tune in, maybe a little bit more convenient time for them. So let me get right at it with my partners in crime. By the way, that tune from Midland, I just can't get that song out of my mind all week. That is an awesome band. Welcome, comedian Joe List and former Major League Baseball general manager Bill Bavasi. Gentlemen, welcome. Where are you guys coming from tonight, if anywhere?
Well,
Go ahead, Joe. You first.
Oh, okay. I'm here in Queens in Astoria in my home, and I just ate an exceptional amount of ice cream on an empty stomach. So if I throw up or pass out or start crying, just go with it.
Okay. Billy?
I'm at home in Southern California, and I'm probably okay. I probably won't throw up or anything.
All right. Well, you know, but you didn't eat ice cream on an empty stomach, right?
I'm envious.
Oh, yeah, I am too. All right, we have our game correspondents, as always, from Syracuse University, and we'll be checking in with them shortly. Hayden Wasserman will be handling the Billings Mustangs at the Rocky Mountain Vibes game. Zach Van Arsdale, no relation to Dick and Thom, we're told anyway, covering the Idaho Falls Chuckers at Missoula Paddleheads game. Matthias Altman-Kurosaki has Northern Colorado against Grand Junction. Austin Murphy is on the Boise Hawks at Ogden Raptors game, and Owen Trainer covering the Glacier Range Riders against the Great Falls Voyagers. Gentlemen, good to have you with us, and we'll be looking forward to hearing from you shortly. Now, tonight, and every week, we try to present something a little bit different. So tonight, we're going to dive into the art, the science, whatever word you want to pick, coin flips, of player trades. Now, look, I mean, it doesn't matter what town you're in, right? You turn on sports talk, and all fans, the media for that matter as well, they want to know what goes on when and how a trade is considered, and then maybe how it does work out or maybe it doesn't work out. And tonight we're going to have the perspective from both the person who makes a trade, a general manager, and, of course, Bill Bavasi did that a number of times as general manager with the Angels and the Mariners, and also – we're going to visit with the great Adam Jones, who was traded from the Mariners to the Orioles. Bill Bavasi, in fact, made that trade for Eric Bedard back in 2008. You know, Billy, it's always so funny because, I mean, heck, even though I was in the game for 33 years, right, I look at things and I say to myself, well, you know, this seems to make sense. That guy for that guy, this team, you know, needs to save a little money, and that seems like it would be. You know what I'm getting at here. Talk about a lot of the things that maybe we don't think about, those of us in the media or fans, about trying to make a trade.
Well, you know, we're not going to sum it up in a little preview here, but, you know, it's no different than the moves you see a manager make on the field. And you had to follow those every day. You know, you're following those, and you might not agree with them. And hindsight is 20/20, right? But when the moves are being made, the one thing you can usually trust is that a lot of thought went into it. A lot of work went into that decision. So everything is done for a reason. You know, the both clubs have a reason to do what they're doing. They have to marry a lot of things, though. You know, they have to marry service time, options left, under control, how long you're going to control the player, budgets, the salary. There are a lot of things that go into it besides player evaluation. But player evaluation is obviously the most important piece. And you have art, which is the scouts that go out and look at these players, and the general manager and his assistants who are trying to put the right chemistry together on the ball club. And then you've got the science, which is now newfound analytics. When I say newfound, I mean over the last 20 years. Mm-hmm. And so you do have an art and a science. And I'm sure, we're going to have a show tonight with Adam and I on it that you're not going to see very often. You don't see Pedro Martinez on too many shows with Fred Clare. So there's something unique about this. And I think as we're talking to him, we'll probably get into this a little bit more because he's a good example. I'd like to think he's going to talk more about his career because it was such a great one.
Yeah.
I will tell you that the one thing I did know when we moved into is that we were moving a great kid. At the time, he was a kid. He was a young guy, but he was mature beyond his years. Just a real good guy, and it worked out that way. He was a big piece of the Baltimore community for a number of years.
And Joe, obviously, you've already gotten a feeling. For those that may not hear this breaking news, I mean, you already have been released by the Range Riders. At least I'm getting word in my ear right now that you've been released and you're going to sign with the Paddleheads. Is that accurate?
Yeah, I don't know what happened. I think maybe they thought, here's my stats coming up. And I guess they thought I was going to be a clubhouse cancer. I don't know if they saw my podcast or maybe heard some of my act. But you know, what can you do? I had a good run with the squad, and we had a nice,
you did?
Had a nice time. Yeah, I mean, well, not a great run. It was a couple minutes, but I enjoyed it, and I was very excited. So I got released, and, what are you going to do? I'm at the Funny Farm next week in Buffalo, so that's a made-up club. But, no, it doesn't feel good to be released, of course. And, my parents didn't release me from the house until I was 27, so.
Well. Then you know the feeling already as an adult being released. So you've already gone down that road before.
Yeah, that's tough. But hopefully I get picked up somewhere.
Yeah, well, we're going to talk about that a little bit later on now because we got big news and it's literally breaking by the minute. So I'm being told. All right. A couple of our crack Syracuse analysts, Matthias Altman-Kurosaki and Hayden Wasserman, are going to take a look. Fellas, tell us about some of the worst trades of all time. And I can actually say that I was traded from the Arizona Diamondbacks to the Cincinnati Reds for a couple of exhibition games. And I think the Diamondbacks made out on that deal and the Reds got the short end of the stick. Having said that, we move on. Gentlemen, take it from here.
So today we have four trades for you. Most of them are old, one of them is newer. The first one is the infamous Nolan Ryan trade. This is going to be a little bit upsetting for Matthias, who's a big Mets fan, but he traded Nolan Ryan to the Angels on December 10th, 1971 for Jim Fregosi.
Yeah.
And while it's well known that it was kind of a fleecing by the end of it, Fregosi was no bum himself. He was 29 years old, but he did have six all-star appearances. He got MVP votes 8 times. He hit, his OPS was 16% above average in his time with the Angels, which is very impressive over that amount of time. The only issue that he had is he missed 55 games with a tumor in his foot in 1971, which was obviously the year before he got traded. Now, the Angels got Nolan Ryan, who we know is one of the best pitchers of all time today. But he was coming off his worst season. He was about an average pitcher at the time. And he had the second worst whip among 89 pitchers with 150-plus innings pitched at the time for 1971 season. And he had the worst walk rate at that time as well for that season. So it's not like he was the pitcher that you think of today as Nolan Ryan. He was a little bit on the downswing, and he was getting a little bit worse. And they also got Leroy Stanton, who was an unproven outfielder. So at the time, it didn't look like such a bad trade. So as you can see in the next slide, Jim Fregosi staying with the New York Mets didn't work out as planned. He continued to suffer injuries, including a broken thumb. He had less than a full season under his belt with the Mets before being traded to the Rangers for cash in 1973, hit 15% below average for OPS, and he only had 5 home runs during his time. Now, the Angels, on the other hand, got off with not one, but two really, really good players. Now, Nolan Ryan's obviously the one you know, but Leroy Stanton he was really, really good too. He played 594 games with the Angels over 5 years. He was their everyday right fielder. And, he played a solid amount, 400-plus plate appearances in 3 seasons, and he had a 110 OPS plus at least in three of those years. And he ranked above Dave Winfield and Lou Brock, who we'll get to later, you know, in OPS plus in 1975. So he was a solid player for them. But obviously, the best player they got was Nolan Ryan, who was basically the best pitcher that time, undoubtedly, in the 8 years he played. He was the best. He had the lowest hits per nine four times. He led in Ks per nine six times with strikeouts per nine. He averaged almost 20 complete games a year, which is just ridiculous as someone who was born in 2002. It's just unheard of. You basically have that amount like every year for the entire MLB. 15% above average in ERA. And he was first in strikeouts during that time period. And that first to second gap is the same as second to 13th, which is just ridiculous. Mm-hmm. And second, by the way, was Thom Seaver. So it's not like it was some random guy. He was a 5-time All-Star in his time with the Angels. And he finished top three in Cy Young voting 3 times. So although it looked like an even trade at the time, Nolan Ryan really developed his game well. He got his walk rate down and he pitched more and more innings and struck out more and more guys. And Fregosi just was towards the end of his career and injury issues struck him, which you'll see as a theme here in these four trades.
So our next trade, it was a trade between two pretty intense division rivals, to say the least, the Cubs and the Cardinals. The Cubs trading Lou Brock to the Cardinals, who at the time was a 25-year-old outfielder, for Ernie Broglio, who was a pretty good starting pitcher for the Cardinals. I mean, 1960, he led the league in wins with 21. He had the lowest hit per nine rate. He also had the best ERA plus. And across six seasons with the Cardinals, a 119 ERA plus is really good. And he posted a 3.00 ERA and a 2.99 ERA in the two seasons prior. However, there were some injury concerns, including him having to get 20 cortisone shots in 1961. Meanwhile, Brock at the time was midway through his third season with the Cubs. He was a pretty fast runner, but only had 50 stolen bases in his career. And he only had an 88 OPS plus through that point in his career, too. Only 77 OPS plus for that season. However, I would add that while it doesn't necessarily show up on his baseball reference page, is that Lou Brock, when he was with the Cubs, was one of the few guys to hit it over the center field fence at the Polo Grounds. So that is one thing. So at the time, I mean, the Cubs are getting a star pitcher. The Cards are getting an unproven outfielder. So really, at the time, it's understandable why they did this. Broglio's stint with the Cubs, though, did not go as planned. Mm-hmm. In 1964, all right, a solid 3.82 ERA. But in 1965 and 1966, in 115 innings pitched, he had an ugly 6.61 ERA, a 6.19 fielding independent pitching, and a negative 2.1 WAR. All these are worst in the majors by a lot. Mm-hmm. And after that, actually, he was also sent to the minors during this stretch, which is pretty disappointing for a guy who looked like an ace. He did not appear in the majors after that 1966 season, and he was only 30 years old. So the Cubs ended up with the short end of the stick for sure. Meanwhile, Lou Brock turned into an absolute superstar in St. Louis, primarily as a left fielder. He was a 6-time All-Star, 6-time stolen base champ, including stealing 118 bases in 1975. He stole 888 bases for his career, most of which with the Cardinals, which is the most anyone's had for one single team. A 112 OPS plus overall, 293 batting average, and he was a top 10 finisher in the MVP voting 5 times. And of course, he's enshrined in Cooperstown as a Hall of Famer. So overall, rough trade for the Cubs and the Cardinals, and made out like bandits.
Yep. One last thing I want to add about that trade is at the time, according to a Wikipedia page, they said that everyone thought the Cubs got a steal, not the other way around. So it wasn't just that they thought it was even. They actually thought that the Cubs robbed them as well. So this next trade is one I'm sure, Thom, you're very familiar with.
Well, in my opinion, this next one should be number one. And I don't say that because
this is in no particular order.
I mean, this is brutal, this trade.
Yeah, this is tough.
Brutal. And the famous line was the DeWitt family, which owns the St. Louis Cardinals now. Bill DeWitt's father was the general manager of the Reds. And the quote is something to the tune of Frank Robinson was an old 30.
Yep, exactly. That's exactly what he said. So he said he's not a young 30, which is really interesting. As you'll see the stats later that he got from the Orioles. But his production went down a little bit, but he was still one of the best players in the league at the time. He was 30 years old. He had won an MVP in 1961. That should say NL MVP. He was a six-time All-Star and 50% better than, you know, an average hitter, which is ridiculous. Now, they did get a solid player in Milt Pappas, who was a 26-year-old starting pitcher. He was already a two-time All-Star, and he had a 2.6 ERA in 1965, and he had a 3.24 ERA in 9 years with the Orioles, which is really, really good, especially at his age. He was still very young. But his underlying stats predicted regression, which obviously is not something they used in 1965, so I'm not blaming them for that. You know, they really just used ERA at that time. But as you can see on the next slide, he didn't pitch super well, according to ERA, with the Reds. His 490 innings in 2.5 seasons, but he did hold a 3.23 fielding independent pitching during this time, which, you know, basically means that can mean that the fielding didn't help him out a lot, and that he limited home runs. That was actually the best of his four total stints, including his one with the Orioles. And that was even better than his 2.60 ERA season, where he had a 3.31 fielding independent pitching, I believe. Yet he still had a 4.04 ERA, which was the worst of his four stints. So although his underlying stats were better, the stats they used at the time looked worse. So they gave him away for almost nothing, but the underlying stats proved to be, they determined how he pitched in the future, as he had a 3.36 ERA after his departure from the Reds for the rest of his career, which is really, really good. But he did not work out for the Reds. Meanwhile, Frank Robinson played six seasons in Baltimore. He won the AL MVP in 1966, World Series MVP, and the Triple Crown, which was the season directly after they traded him. So immediately it just looked like a terrible trade. He was a six-time All-Star after age 30, which is nuts. And he hit 300, had 179 home runs, and a 169 OPS plus, which was 19% better than he actually had on the Reds, where he was still a fantastic player. He finished top three in AL MVP voting three times. So the Orioles really made out like bandits here. And the Reds GM didn't look so good on that comment.
No, no.
And I will add one more thing, which is that 1966 World Series, my father was a Dodgers fan at the time because of Sandy Koufax, and so he did not take too kindly to that. But anyway, here's our last trade, which you alluded to earlier, Thom. The Mariners trading Adam Jones to the Orioles in February of 2008. So the full trade was that the Mariners received Eric Bedard for Adam Jones, Chris Tillman, George Sherrill, and Cam Micolio, which – to be fair to the Mariners, Eric Bedard was coming off a fantastic season and a great stretch for the Orioles. No, he was 28 years old at the time. He's fifth in the Cy Young voting in 2007, led the league with a 10.9 strikeouts per nine, had a 3.16 ERA and a 3.19 FIP. He also had the best hits per nine rate at 7.0. He struck out just over 30% of the batters he faced. So really, you can't blame the Mariners, who went 88-74 the year before, for doing this trade, really. As for the other guys going to Baltimore, I mean, Adam Jones was 22 at the time. He had some cups of coffee in 06 and 07, but not a ton of playing time. Chris Tillman was a top 100 prospect. He was only 19 years old at the time, starting pitcher. And George Sherrill, who was a stalwart in the Seattle bullpen. So those were the pieces going to Baltimore, along with Micolio, who's a minor league reliever. Anyways, Bedard wasn't bad necessarily in Seattle. He started 46 games between 2008 and 2011, 255 in the third innings pitched with a 3.31 ERA. But he also did not pitch at all in 2020 because of shoulder injuries, and his 2008 and 2009 seasons were both shortened by injuries. The injuries, he suffered a torn labrum, and he had to undergo shoulder surgery. And then in the summer of 2011, the Mariners traded him to the Red Sox at the trade deadline. So that was an unceremonious end to Bedard's career with Seattle, which really looked promising and just got derailed by injuries. Moving right along to how the Baltimore side played out, George Sherrill was an All-Star 2008, albeit with a 4.73 ERA, but still – hit 31 saves and remained as the closer in 2009, had a 2.40 ERA, and then was traded to the Dodgers since the Orioles were out of the race. So he finished that year with a 1.70 ERA in total. Then moving on to Chris Tillman, he was actually a stalwart for the Orioles in their rotation. He threw just over 1,100 innings. He played in 10 seasons for Baltimore. He was an all-star in 2013 and really led those successful Orioles pitching staffs to a few playoff appearances. He won at least 11 games 4 years in a row, three seasons with at least 30 starts and 110 ERA plus. While his career ERA is only 4.57, that's partially inflated by the last couple years where he struggled. But overall, Chris Tillman was one of the better pitchers for some pretty good Baltimore teams. He even started the wild card game in 2016. And, of course, the last piece of this trade, Adam Jones, who played 10 seasons primarily as the center fielder for the Orioles, was a five-time All-Star, a four-time Gold Glover, won a Silver Slugger in 2013, career overall hit 279, 319, 459 with a 109 OPS plus and 263 homers. So he was far beyond what was initially envisioned, I would say. He basically was the face of the Orioles for a bit, and yeah, that's how it all played out.
And, you know, Billy, I want to ask you about this before we get Adam to come on here. In that, you know, when you're looking at your team and the year before, you win 88 games and you're thinking, okay, you know, we need that guy. I remember when this trade happened. And look, nobody at that point in time, and I'm not sitting here defending you or anything else. I'm just saying, at that point in time, you just saw Cheryl's 19 years old. Adam Jones is 22 years old. He'd been up and down a couple of times over 2 years. And look, you know, the old adage, you got to give up something to get something. And I imagine you're saying to yourself, we get Bedard, we go to maybe 91, 92, 93 wins next year and end up in the playoffs.
Well, you know, it's all part of a good book in the future, I'm sure. But that organization at that time, you know, we had won 88 games the year before. And, you know, if you don't win 91, 92 the next year, everybody's gone. And, you know, the year before when we won 88 in 2007, I actually went into a series against Kansas City. I can't remember what month this was, but, and the owners had come in and said, you know what? Yeah, we're playing four games against this team. And if we don't win, I can't remember if it was three out of four or two out of four, somebody's got to go. Either a Bavasi or Hargrove's got to go. And so Mike and I talked about it. We said, hey, we really can't change anything. We're just going to, you know, play with the kids we have. We're trying to get better. But then we did decide, you know, we kind of want to stick around here. So let's put an effort in these games. And we just beat the crap out of these guys for 4 days. But it was an odd spot to be in. And so in the offseason, we knew we had to get better. We lost, I think, around 23 home runs and 100 RBIs from Jose Guillen, who went on to be a free agent. We signed him for 1 year because he was coming back from Tommy John surgery. And so we're losing a lot of offense. And we felt we either need to get offense or pitching. And this was the best guy on the market by far at that time. And we had a lot of people, smart guys in our organization, that this was the one guy they would go out on a limb on. Mm-hmm. The real odd thing here that really to this day annoys the hell out of me, we had just rehired some field staff, and one was Sam Perlazzo. Yep. Sam Perlazzo was Eric's manager for the 2 years before. And so I called, you know, we called Sam and said, hey, you know, we're putting together a final piece to this deal. And if it works, we're going to be a decent club. If it doesn't work, we're going to set this organization back 10 years. And so what do you have on this guy's makeup? That's all. What he got on his makeup. And Sam signed off on it. Sam said he was all right. And he got to us, and maybe it was within the first month, our trainer came upstairs and said, hey, you're in big trouble. I said, really, why? He said, Bedard doesn't want to be here. And I just heard him downstairs complaining in the training room saying, you know, when I was in Baltimore, we were just a lousy team trying to get better every day and just a bunch of young kids trying to play hard. He said, here, they expect you to win.
Yep, I remember that.
And I thought, okay, you're dead. You're gone. You might as well resign now. So I do believe that, you know, when you go out on a limb and you make a deal like that and it doesn't work, you should get fired.
Let me ask you this, Billy.
Subscribe to that.
I want to jump in on it because, again, this is something that I think most people, me included, don't know about. I think I do, but I think a lot of people don't, is that when you're getting ready to make a trade like this, you're not allowed to pick up the phone and call Eric Bedard and ask him how he feels about coming to Seattle, right?
You can get permission to do that, but that's in a deal like this, no.
Right.
And in fact, you know, you really only get those permissions if you really feel you need to sign him and you're going to make a deal contingent on my being able to extend this guy's contract because I don't want to take him for just a year. But we had him under control for a few more years. But I will say that it was difficult to do the deal. Andy McPhail, who is a prince, you know, this guy's a great guy and he's honest as the day is long. I can't say as much for Mr. Angelos. You know, he got in the way of this thing and he was a real pain, you know, and he wanted Adam. I think we put Adam through a lot of unreasonable processes there. He had to go through a physical for them. And then they balked at his results. You know, they ended up taking them. But then when it came time for me to put Eric through a physical, Angelos didn't want any part of that. Oh. We ended up getting it done, and he did pass a physical. But it was you know, Andy McPhail who is at the top of the game. He is fabulous. I think he was given. I think his owner did a disservice for him. He just made the whole thing a real tough deal to get done.
And Joe, we know that your Boston Red Sox have never traded away any good players.
No, no. I feel like Jeff Bagwell wouldn't have done well with the monster out there and left 310 down the line for a right-handed slugger. I don't think that would have worked out great.
No, not at all. And wait a minute, you're also forgetting some guy named Babe.
Oh yeah, Babe Ruth. Yeah. Well, didn't we get Ice Capades or some kind of? No, that was Bill Russell. We got a Broadway show, Nanu Nanny or Nanny Nanu. I can't remember my history, but we did trade Heathcliff Slocum for Jason Varitek and Derek Lowe, and they won a World Series.
There you go. Well, we were just talking about him. Let's bring in kind enough to join us tonight, the great Adam Jones. Adam, how are you? Where are you? What are you up to these days, man?
I'm just working on my golf game right now in Arizona. Just trying to just figure out life after baseball. And it's been fun. The first 6 months, it's been weird. Obviously, spring training, not going to a baseball field, still watching baseball. But it's been great. The body doesn't hurt. And I told my wife, because she's mad that I golf too much now. Now she's a golf wife. And I just told her that, look, I still can swing the bat. I still need to swing something, but I can't run. So this is the perfect substitute. And,
you know, I think working a lot so far. Of times, you know, Adam, I remember when I was announcing the Arizona Diamondbacks games with Mark Grace. And Mark had just stepped away from the field. And it was the first time I had had a partner that literally just stepped right off the field. And I remember we were getting ready for a game one night in San Francisco, and Mark and I got into it. You know, I jumped his ass pretty good about not being ready for the telecast and all this kind of stuff. And Mike Kruko and Dwayne Kuiper in the booth next door, and they're really good friends of mine. And they came over the next day and they said, "Hey, listen, I know, you know, you got high expectations for Mark. I know him and you go way back to your Cub days in a whole nine yards." He said, "But you got to understand, when a player leaves the game, there's a big hole there." Have you felt like that?
No, honestly, really? I think okay. that right. no, honestly, personally, I think going to Japan was like my weaning out of the game. Of course, who doesn't want to play until the, you know, they can't anymore. But I think going to Japan was myself weaning out the game, opposed to the year before. I didn't sign until, I think March 13th, you know, if I seen that in the future, I'm like, well, let me just go over and do something crazy. And, it was good weaning out. And then my wife, she has a travel company. So I'm just like, look, let's just go live. I mean, I think the game's been too fruitful. I done worked my ass off too hard to be like, oh man, to have any bad sorrows or anything. Like there's a void. I miss baseball in terms of the guys. I miss the drive to the park. I miss, you know, just all the little intricacies. I don't miss chasing a ball down in a gap. I don't miss sliding the bases. I don't miss hitting 92, 98 now with sink. Yeah. I don't miss none of that. Yeah. I don't miss none of that. And Mr. Bavasi, how you doing, man? I have not seen you in a while. I hope everything is good.
Yeah, I know.
With a lot of things, so it's great to see you.
I was wondering if you knew I was going to be on this, man. You know, I'll tell you what, I have been so excited watching your career, even though, you know, it was such a horrible. Let me tell you something. You know, when you watch movies and like it's a scary movie or it's a villain movie and somebody there's always a scene where somebody just wakes up at night and they sit up in bed and go, holy Jesus, did I just do that? And that's you. So I still, like every month I wake up and think, oh my God, did I really do that? But I'll tell you what, man, as bad as the deal was, it was such a thrill to watch what you did with your career on and off the field. I think it's obvious what you did on the field, but what I was paying attention to was what you were doing off the field. You're such a leader in your community. I was just, and I'll tell you what, I was proud of you, not because you were a Mariner, but you're from San Diego, right?
Yep.
And
of course,
as a San Diego man, I was rooting for you, and God, you became such an important part to the city of Baltimore and that organization, and I just am so proud of you and excited for you.
Well, no one thing. It all started with, 18-year-old kid coming into an organization, and I had first guy I meet is Mike Goff, like. Hard to the know military in baseball. If there ever was a sergeant in baseball, Mike Goff would be that guy. And him and Willie Bloomquist, JJ Putz said, I don't give a damn if you're a first rounder. Your ass is about to work. And those three dudes, and I still talk to Willie. I mean, he's the head coach at ASU along with Mike Goff now. And you know, it was from day one, it was work, install work. So when I got traded to Baltimore, I went to a brand new organization. Didn't know nobody. And I got with T-Bone Shelby and we worked. We got with Juan Samuel. He's the infield coach, but we still worked. And it was all about getting around good coaches. And I learned that with Seattle is that you got to have good coaches that want to work with you opposed to like, you know, I've seen a lot of guys get coddled, but I was like, well, you know, I don't care. Cause I always had Willie texting me, hey, what you doing? How you doing? He wanted to pay attention to everything I was doing because he wanted to be my teammate. We was able to be teammates soon thereafter. And another great guy in that journey was Greg Dobbs. And I was supposed to golf with him last week in Newport. But he you know, when he runs a financial world, he gets busy here and there. But it's like I had those guys that, again, those four guys are not Hall of Fame guys. Not you need to know baseball to know those guys.
Yeah.
And then those guys are a reason why I see these attributes or these stats up. Those are the reason why I had those, because even when I got traded over to Baltimore, you think that Willie wasn't texting me, hey, why aren't you hustling? Hey, let's go, let's go. And you know, those are the reasons why. But all that started in Seattle. That started with, I still talked with D. Gardner. It starts with Gary Thurman, Darren Brown. I mean, I'm just naming all my coaches. I mean, it starts with all those guys because. When I got to the Mariners, I mean the Orioles, I was in the big leagues.
Yeah,
it was already big leagues. Is not time to hey, let's get better at this. Now the big leagues is show and go. And then it's my first time playing against New York, and A-Rod, Bernie Williams, Jeter, Cano. I mean they lineup felt like they was all 7 feet tall, and you know the Orioles, we just getting our teeth kicked in. But I still was like, hey man, nah, we gonna come and whoop their ass too. And you see how the transformation come. Obviously, it wasn't all by myself, but the way I played baseball, fundamentally sound, if you watch how I did every single thing, that's Seattle. Yeah. The credit, obviously, is going to go to the Orioles because I made all-star games there, but it's the foundation of my career. The first 4 years of my career, getting my ass handed to me every day by Mike Goff is the reason why I went on.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'll tell you
what. I never forgot that.
Yeah, those are really good points that guys like Goff and Thurman, all those guys want to hear. You know, that's really what they take home. And you know, the you're clearly the worst trade I was ever involved in. But you know, you're really similar to a guy in the best trade I ever made, which was I traded Chad Curtis when he was young for Tony Phillips. I don't know if you remember that name at all.
I know Tony Phillips, Angels. What?
Yeah, Tony Phillips is that guy that that Matt Keogh, God rest his soul, actually both of them, Matt recommended him in a deal. And he said, you know what? Here's what he'll do that other players won't. He'll make Jim Edmonds, JT Snow, Tim Salmon, Gary DeSarcina. He'll make these guys better. He'll make them better players. And that's what you became. You became that player that made other players better. And that's part of your community. You know what I mean? You know, that's part of what made you great in the city with the organization and with your teammates, because it was real apparent that I saw other guys get better when you got better there too.
You met my mom, rest her soul.
Yes.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah. She wouldn't tolerate nothing. I mean, if you got to meet my grandma, you'd know that she wouldn't tolerate nothing either. So it was easy to lead by example, because the example was, I'm where I'm from, you got to shut up and play the game hard. You got to put up numbers. Ain't no crying. Ain't no nothing. You just, and it's, again, I'm the late era. I'm the last era of the coddling, I believe.
Yep.
I don't even think you can call somebody a bonus baby anymore. You might might go to HR. You call somebody.
Yeah, you got it. You got it.
You know what I'm saying?
I know what you're saying.
You can't even say, oh, you're pandering me. You know, shut the hell up. You got damn $2 million, you jackass. You are a bad thing. I just got $10,000 and a Greyhound ticket.
You came out of Morris High School, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a great baseball school, great baseball program, great athletic programs, but people weren't fooling around.
But you know, I want to ask Adam about when you, because you were primarily, until I think about like 12, I was reading, is the first time that your stepdad, I think, took you to a Padres game, and you fell in love with baseball at that point. You were a great football player, great basketball player. But coming out of high school, and correct me, Adam, if I'm wrong here, you were a shortstop and a pitcher. Now, in high school baseball, the two best athletes generally on the team, or the best athlete on the team, is either a pitcher or a shortstop. You're both. We've seen in recent years, you know, Shohei's a different animal altogether, because he's doing both and something nobody's done since really Babe Ruth. But right. Hunter Green, a couple of years ago, when he was a number one pick, there was a lot of debate. Would he be a pitcher? Would he be an offensive player? What did you want to be? Did you want to be the position player, or back then, did you think you wanted to be a pitcher?
Hell no. I wanted to play shortstop, and I had a good arm. So the coach was like, for my freshman year, they would put you on the mound. I was playing shortstop and I had a good arm. And then my senior year, it went up to 92 to 96. They were like, hey, you're going to be our starter. You got to be our ace because you throw hard. And then when I went into the showcases, I obviously had to pitch. I wanted to showcase everything I wanted to do, because I didn't say, oh, I just want to play short. I'm not going to showcase everything. That'd be rock. When I drafted my man, I told Frank Maddox, RIP, a great guy, I said, look, I want to play shortstop, and knock on wood, if I can't hit, then, hey, my arm is good. Let's go on the mound, because projections was – in some aspects that I wouldn't hit past double A. And there's a lot of projections on a lot of guys like that. There's guys that went way higher than me that were supposed to be this and that. But that's the draft. That's the tricky part of it. And Bill, that's impossible to just quantify who's going to be good. So I just grinded it out. I just grinded it out. But like, I think for what Shohei wanted to be like Shohei, I think, you know, spending 2 years in Japan, the work that they do, it can be done. It's just extremely hard to do, and it takes a lot of work. Now, that guy, he might sleep like a newborn baby. I mean, because he has to be exhausted. He has to play catch. He gets one day off to play catch. He hits every day. I see here and there they mix when he's not DH, and they just give him a full day off, which I think is great. You got to give the man rest. But it's like he's on the field stretching early, and then takes from stretching early to hitting. Now, I get he doesn't hit on the field, but he's doing a lot. And I had this conversation with Bobby Bonilla yesterday. Is he the most valuable player? Because he's hitting 270, 16, and 50, and he has a sub 3 with, 80 innings thrown.
Well, all I know is that if there's been a human being alive that had a back-to-back day stretch that he had – what, 2 weeks ago, where he hits 3 home runs in one game, knocks in 9 runs, and the next day he starts and pitches, what, 8 shutout innings?
13 strikeouts. Like, that's never been done before. Like,
it's insane.
It's special watching him. Now, can it be done again? I never say never, but I mean, as you've seen, it was Babe Ruth and then him. So I mean, you got some pitchers who can hit, like Bumgard, Greinke. I mean, there were some guys, Wainwright guys, who, you know, who really, really could swing the bat. But Mike Hampton, who I golfed with a couple weeks ago, but ain't nobody ever been like him. And, you know, Babe Ruth, this Babe Ruth conversation is going to be over once you pass 100 starts. Okay, we get it. Babe Ruth did this for a very, very short amount of time. If Shohei does this 3-4 more years, he's in a league of his own. Is he going to catch Babe Ruth home runs? No, time just permits that. But it's never something. He's doing something that's never been done. And again, everybody always say Babe Ruth, I mean, great player. He also played against people who pumped his gas on his way, even if there was cars back then. I think there was. No discredit to him, though, because everybody had the same level playing field.
You know, we're talking, Adam, about the, you know, the art, the science of a trade. But, you know, all the years I've been in baseball, there's also the human element of the trade. Talk about what happens when you know, you find out you're getting traded, and now all of a sudden you're living in Seattle. You're sent to literally the other side of the planet to get to Baltimore. You got to find an apartment. You got to get packed. You weren't married yet. But tell us about how that whole whirlwind, what's that like for a player?
Well, for me, the only thing that, I mean, obviously the transition, I mean, it's business. I learned that early in business. So that wasn't a part that like was affected me, learning new people. I mean, I learned new people with the Mariners. I just had learned new people with the Orioles. I just had a little bit more professionalism at the time. You know what I mean? A little more experience, knew how to carry myself a little bit better being 22. But the only thing that annoyed the hell out of me was, we were in the finals of the championship in Venezuela. And we were up 2-1 against the Tigres de Aragua, against Miguel Cabrera's team. And after game 3, they told me I couldn't play anymore. And that was the only part that kind of, like, I was like, damn, because again, everybody knew what was going on in America. And because a couple weeks before, I had to stop playing for a couple days because there was a potential trade, could have been, I think, Minnesota or something. I'm not sure if I remember all that correctly, but I had to stop for a couple days and I got to resume. But I felt like I'm letting my team down, but I understand, I knew it. And then it turned around that I only got $7,000 in the championship final package opposed to $31,000. So that really pissed me off. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
It's the small thing. And I mean, that $31,000, that $12,000 I was making down there was heaven. That $31,000 would have been.
Yeah, because like the minimum then was about 89, 90,000?
No, it was 330 when I first
got here. Oh, okay. All right. I was a very young man. What am I thinking about? Never mind.
Yeah, I was parts of 2 years, but like that winter ball money was icing on the cake, because the projection was for me to start 08 in the big leagues. I mean, again, if a strong spring training happens, a lot of different factors. Ichiro wanted, I don't know if he wanted to play center field again. Who knows? So when I went over to Baltimore, it was just like, damn. Like, you know, it's different, but I remember my brother said, bro, you about to get to play every single day. And that was all he said, and hung up the phone. And I'm like, in my second day, Dave Tremblay came to me and said, hey, you're my center fielder, it's your job to lose. And we're sitting here talking. I went out there every day. I need to earn this job every day. I need to earn it. So I played my ass off. And I still remember every time when I was in the outfield, Golfy always said, if it hits the grass, that's your ass. I lost the ball in the sun. I'll never forget this, playing left field. I lost the ball in the sun in Oakland. And I let down Gilmesh so bad. He was dealing the game. It was in the 7th inning. And in Oakland, that sun was sitting in my damn eye. And I lost the ball. And Gilmesh came up to me and was like, hey, don't worry about it, man. I felt so bad. Next day, we were back home in Seattle. 3:00, that sun was perfectly in Seattle. I went out there every single day the rest of the season and worked on sun balls. And I don't think – I maybe missed one in Baltimore in 11 years.
Joe.
Yeah, I have a question. Hey, Adam. I'm Joe. I'm a comedian, and this is something I've always wondered about baseball. Big fan of the game. You got 25 guys on a squad. You know, it's February to October. You don't have to name names, but what's it like to have just a guy you hate in the clubhouse? Because I just can't imagine. As a comedian, if I see someone in the lineup, I'm like, I can't stand this guy. I got to see him for an hour. Can it ruin your season, or can you just avoid them? It just seems like the plane, the clubhouse, all day for 6 months, 7 months.
Well, I think Major League, the obviously the final scene when the third baseman comes up to him and said, strike them out. I think that is the culmination of somebody you don't necessarily like, but at the end of the day, our common goal is to win. And then, you know, knock the hell out of him afterwards. I think that whole part right there, minus the, you know, sleeping with his wife and all that kind of stuff, minus that part.
That I'm into. That whole
but that whole culmination right there is sometimes how it is. Like, you're not going to like everybody in your workplace, but the common goal is to win a championship, because everybody wins a championship. Everybody gets to go on that nice plane, the trips. It is just lovely. It is great for an organization when you win, when you get to the playoffs. So you're not going to like everybody in your workplace, but the common goal is to win, and people do what they have to do, and you sacrifice your lip sometimes for that common goal. But I mean, players, we have it a little bit different. We can say, you know, shut the hell up and squabble in the clubhouse all we want, because I mean, unless you can't do it on the field, as you've seen, fam, I told you, you can't do stuff like that. But you know, you're not gonna like everybody, but you just got to be professional about it, and you can avoid people. But you know, at the same time, you're going to have to high five to some bitch if he does something good. If you're driving a run when the game is on the line, when we're between them lines, you're going to have to be a teammate. But outside of that, you ain't got to take nobody to dinner. You ain't got to be around nobody.
Adam, you go on to become one of the great players in the history of the Orioles franchise. And that is a franchise that I don't need to tell you. But, you know, for maybe the younger crowd, they think the Orioles, oh, God, they haven't been any good forever. But they were good forever. They were good when you first got there, and you're winning gold gloves, and you get the big contract, and you're going to the All-Star games, and on and on and on. Then all of a sudden, the franchise starts to do this. How hard was that?
Well, it sucked, because you always – I mean, once you get that taste of winning, 2012, we went to the wild card game, won that, went to the playoffs against the Yankees, lost that game five. But that energy – like, it has not happened since 1997, that energy in Baltimore. I didn't realize that energy in Baltimore. Then 13 comes. We're a good team. We're competitive. We're just short of it. 14, we win the division. What? Beating the Yankees in the division? Like, I didn't realize it. Like, I got getting to the playoffs against them. But beating them in a division, though, that means, like, taking their crown. That's something it's just incredible. And then, you know, after 14, Markakis expired contract. I guess nobody wants to do the fourth year of his contract in Atlanta. It was his best year of his career. Arguably, he went to the All-Star game, gold glove. But I'm not, you know, I can't predict the future. Right. Nelson Cruz, nobody wants to do the four-year deal, I guess, in Baltimore. All 4 years, I think 1 year he had 39, but he had 39 every year and 100 every year. I think we could have used that. Not to say anything about Trumbo and Davis and whoever else on our team. I wanted, you know, I rooted for my teammates every single day. But when we had all those collectively, and we could afford them at the time because we were winning, and Bill, you know this, when you win, you can afford things. Yep. People tend to open their pocket a little bit more. And when we didn't sign those two guys, I just think that, you know, myself, Manny, JJ, it was hard for four guys, you know, to carry a guys when we had a 1-9 that's trying to take you deep. It was, you know, that shrunk. And, you know, it's just hard. And when the time comes to pay guys, you know, it gets tough too. And I just think we just ran out of gas as a group. And, you know, some pieces just started to go other ways. And, you know, and then it went to a whole rebuild, I think, after halfway through 17. And you know, I think now I think Elias is doing a great job there. You see that right now. They're in every game. They're very competitive every night. Now, are they gonna win every single game? I think experience in some things are going to fault them and hurt them against the Yankees and against the Astros and Boston and certain teams that have been there. But they're going to play their ass off every night. And I think that's all you can ask, and that's all the city asks. And hopefully they rebuild a winner, get some arms in there that can – sustain at East, because that ain't fun. Oh my gosh, that's not fun. And you know, hopefully they get back to competitiveness, because seeing what Baltimore has for baseball, the love they have for baseball, they love football. They're in love with baseball.
Yeah,
they love football though, but they're in love with baseball deeply.
Billy,
you know, when you were in Seattle, we moved you off shortstop, and that's a heartbreak for a lot of guys. Were you okay with that?
At first I wasn't like heartbroken. At first I was like, hey, why? Gary Thurman, because it was like August 4th or 5th. I mean, we're in San Antonio. Gary Thurman, I'm like, why? He's like, hey, we're going to go out and start working on center field. I'm like, why? He's like, you know, we just signed Betancourt. We just traded for Morris and Jeremy Reed. And Betancourt, I don't know if he just got called up, but he was around the corner from getting called up. And I think he played 3 or 4 games. And Morris's ass was in left field the next day, too. We all, once you seen Betancourt, it was like, no organization. You gone. Cabrera went from the, it just, every day, all you guys, you moving. And Thurman came up to me and was like, hey, man. He said, look, I don't give a damn how you get to the big league. Hit. They want your bat. You athletic, you can go to center field. They want your bat. And he was like, okay. I was doing really well in double A. And I just was like, okay, there's another position. Then I went to fall league and I was talking to Frank Maddux. Because I was obviously still playing shortstop in double A all throughout the playoffs. But I was still working every day, taking fly balls, working in center field. Get to fall league and I'm with Gary Pettis. And then I see Frank Maddux. I'm like, yeah, Frank, you know, hey, you know, should I be taking ground balls or short? And he's like, just gave me that look. And I was like, and I just ran the hell away from him, went out to center field and just, I gave everything, all my energy and all my attention to Gary Pettis for those 6 weeks. Mm-hmm. And I was like, dude, I know who you are. I've seen you. I didn't see you play. I know your accolades. Teach me how to play center field. And he had me as early. And I had dinner with him a few weeks ago. And he was just reminiscing on that. We were. And he was the first guy, I mean, obviously Thurman, but he was the first guy that had hands-on every single day with me in center field. And, you know, I think there's a little bit of resemblance in that and somehow in some of the ways we played. I was like, at first I was like, all right, damn, what's going on? Gary Thurman said, get that bat ready. And then you've seen, I went to AAA and I was up in what, three, you called me up at the All-Star break.
Yeah.
New position.
Yeah. That, you know, my whole career, I come from like a player development background more than anything else. And it was the fastest way for you to get to the big leagues. And I always believe that we kind of sign a covenant with your parents, with you, with your brothers and sisters, with everybody that, hey, we'll take care of this kid. We'll get him to the big leagues as fast as we can because, you know, shelf life is, you know, it doesn't last forever. And so you guys deserve to have somebody get you to the big leagues as soon as possible. Not rushed, but get there as soon as possible. It's interesting you mentioned Gary. I was with the Angels when I was just an assistant in the minor leagues, but I was there when we took him off shortstop and put him in center field. I think he was going into double A. And then about 2 years later, we did the same thing. We took Devon White off of third base and shortstop and put him in center field. And those are two, you know, there's those two, you,
Sean Dunstan.
Yeah. But I wouldn't know him.
Eric Davis was another one that is a minor leaguer, was a shortstop.
You three are the best natural center fielders I've ever seen. You know, and it comes natural. I mean, I know you worked at it. I get it. Mm-hmm. So did Gary and so did Devon. But there's a gift. You know, there's a gift you got.
Yeah. I always took the infield. I took the infield out there. So, like, you know, I never was afraid of the short hops and the balls off the wall, anything – that was really quick. I was working around the bag was always real easy of stabbing the ball. So like the confidence, you know, those guys installed in me was good. And then again, getting traded over to Baltimore, I full-time center field because 07, I was doing a little bit of right. Like, I think I got called back up and I was playing a little bit of left and then Ibanez went off and I'm just a pinch hitter, pinch runner late. And hey, it is what it is. Yeah. And, but I went to Baltimore, and then I got T-Bone Shelby, another guy who, you know, a fantastic athlete, fantastic center fielder.
Yeah.
So, I had guys that taught me how to play center field. And to this day, funny thing about shortstop, Wayne Kirby to this day will still say, if I was a shortstop, I'd be playing in Mexico. And Bill Bavasi did me the best job ever. You should write him a check. That's what it's just verbatim. He says that all the time.
I don't know about that. You're pretty good shortstop. I don't know about that.
Joe?
I had another quick question, Adam, and I might be projecting with some of these questions, but you've made multiple All-Star teams, and I'm really interested in obviously you're proud of yourself to make the All-Star game. It feels good to be an All-Star, but there must be part of you that's bummed. You go, man, I wanted to go home for 3 days. Now I got to go to whatever, Atlanta, and talk to press. And talk a little bit about the plus and minuses of making the All-Star. You get a little shorter vacation or no vacation, but you also have a festival atmosphere, I imagine.
Well, you get no vacation. The best part is you get a bonus. The worst part is the bonus is spent on jets, getting people there and from, tickets, headaches. Oh, my goodness, it's a headache. I mean, my first one was great. It was just my mom and my girlfriend at the time. Fantastic. Nobody. My second one, in it was 12. Yep. Just got my contract like a month before. So everybody was like, no, we going to the All-Star game. So I had to get a jet to go here. And then after those, the next four or five were jets everywhere. Then my mom wants to kick. My mom's like, I ain't going here. You're flying private. So I'm flying private from here. So it turned into a circus, but it always was a blessing because you're amongst the best of the best. Again, at the time, hey, but those are going to be guys that are going to be 10-time All-Stars. They're going to be guys that are one-time All-Stars. But you're around the game's best at the present time, and you're around everyone's fans. Only one that's getting booed really is like the division rival of the fan. So when the Orioles come, get a couple. Cool, what's up, man? How you doing? It was, no boo. In New York, you got a Nationals fan or something, like, just wearing them out. But all of them were blessings. Again, there were headaches to it with hotels and this and that. But again, it was just money. I wouldn't change anything like that. And I hope that all these players, I hope they all got headaches but get to experience it with their family and their loved ones, because it is truly an amazing time. And
last thing I want to ask,
it's hard to do.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. And you did it, six, seven times. Last thing I want to ask you about, we were discussing this topic, Adam, and you sort of touched on it a little while ago about when you got in the minor leagues, your coaches down there. Yeah, you were a first round pick, but they were going to kick you in the tail. They were going to push you. They were going to push your buttons if they had to find out where those buttons were. And we talk about some of these quote unquote, new age managers we've talked about, and now some of the old school guys that are getting a chance to come back into the big leagues again. Dusty really never left, but for the year or so. But you played for Buck Showalter in Baltimore. You talk about, an older guy coming in, and let's face it, I mean, I was with Showalter for a number of years in Arizona. There's some people that really like him, and there's some people that really don't like him. I think that's fair to say, and that's not knocking Buck Showalter.
True.
But do you think guys like Buck Showalter are really good for younger players right now? Because maybe they players do want some of that sort of prodding, and let's start getting after people.
I think in today's climate, I think he's been able to adjust to today's climate of players. Again, is he a hard ass? Still is. Red, beeping, boom, boom, beeping red, wants to cuss out the next everything. But he understands the today's climate of the player. And with us in Baltimore, when he got there, everybody just like, Buck's going to do it. I was like, man, well, he can't whoop my ass. Well, I mean, like, he wants one thing. Play the game hard.
Yep.
Play it right. Play it smart. Doing dumb shit will piss him off. Running into outs will piss him off. And again, any manager. But to him, to the 10th degree. I mean, to where you might not see the field. He just wanted you to play smart. And I think what we did in Baltimore, were we athletic? Yeah. Were we the best team on the field in terms of every single position? No. We played the best defense. We played the smartest defense. We threw to the right bases. He made us efficient in every aspect of the game. But again, we had flaws. We were a big strikeout team. We didn't have the best pitching staff, but we made up with being smart, learning how to be in position, learning. We study defense. We actually like really study defense individually. Me and Hardy would talk about defense all the time because being the shortstop and center fielder, like we studied the game. We knew that, okay, we can't outslug the Yankees or the Red Sox at the time. But you know what? When we got these little things and we got bases loaded, we have to get two. Ain't no just grounding to a double play and getting one and getting out. No, we have to get two. And we harped on such small things. And you see what he's doing right now with the Mets. Last year, they were ass in all aspects of it. There ain't no kiss. There's no way to cookie cut it. And right now, they're doing all the small things to win the game. Again, they have star power, but they're doing all the small things. And they don't even have two of the game's best pitchers.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, and Showalter will force you to do the small things, because if you don't, you ain't gonna play. And look who's next to him every time, the face of the franchise, Francisco Lindor. And if he's doing it, everybody's gonna do it. When he got there, Markakis is the face of the franchise. Markakis is busting his ass. I'm following it. B-Rob following it. Then we trickle down to JJ, Weeders, then the new wave, Machado. You see the way Machado plays today. It's like you play hard because it's installed in you to play a game the one way. Even if you come up in this era of, you know, again, you can't say certain words to guys, certain prima donnas or whatever you want to. It's a different era. But you still have some old school baseball players that's out there. And you see the way the Astros play. They play old school style baseball because their manager understands that he has unbelievable athleticism. But there's still things you can do old school that still work.
Yeah.
And Buck does that greatly.
Well, Adam, we've taken a lot of your time tonight, and we just can't thank you enough. This has been awesome having you with us, and we're so glad you look great. So glad to hear you're doing well and enjoying golf. What do you got to handicap at before we let you go? You got
I'm 14 right now. No, I ain't cheating. 14. I'm a 14 right now. Today I got my first eagle ever.
Where? I lived in Arizona forever. Where'd you play today?
True North.
Nice. Very nice.
Yeah, I did at True North. Very narrow. I didn't like it. I was scared.
Yeah, I mean, those desert courses can be tough. There's no doubt. Adam, all the best, man.
Always. Good to see you guys. Bill, hey, man.
Great to see you, Adam. You look terrific, man.
Thank you.
Really happy.
Joe, good to meet you, brother.
Nice to meet you, my friend. Appreciate it.
Adam, take it easy, man. Boy, he was great. That was a lot. You know, Billy, I got to tell you, I felt really good there that you had a chance to talk to him. I don't want to get overly sappy or emotional or things like that. But, hey, you know, you never know sometimes if some guy's been walking around harboring, you know, any ill will towards you. You know what I'm saying?
No, I knew he didn't. He's just above that, man. You know, you got a little glimpse into this guy. He is a fabulous human being. And, you know, when he was 18, it was the same guy. He just had a little bit higher voice, you know, and – otherwise it was the same guy, man. And he gave a lot of credit to a lot of people. I love to hear that. I will tell you though, he didn't need it. He was going to play hard. He was going to do stuff right. He was going to find out what to do right. So, I mean, I love the guy, and I wasn't exaggerating. I wasn't hyperbole. I do wake up at least once a month and go, holy Jesus, you know, you gotta be kidding me.
That's going to happen. It happens to every single general manager.
I do that with my wife. I go, this is what you gotta be kidding.
Yeah, I know that feeling too.
That was a great guest. I really enjoyed that. I really did. No,
that was awesome. That was one of my favorite ones we've ever done. It was really great.
So, Joe, it seems to me that you know, we're gonna say this because we're gonna wait a little while and hope you will fill us in on exactly what is going on with your playing career starting next week. So, we're gonna talk about that certain comedian who's making his pro baseball debut on Tuesday. How's that for a tease? We'll do that when we come back. Stick with us on the PBL Roundup Show.
Junction Rockies single game tickets are on sale right now. Be a part of the excitement and catch something fun at every game, from theme nights to dollar hot dogs to $2 drafts. For a full promotional schedule and to get your tickets, go to gjrockies.com for Grand Junction Rockies baseball. We'll see you at Saplesio Field. Get your tickets today.
Thank you. 5'8. I feel more defiant when y'all hate. Yeah, the only brother in the car race. Turn a with a butter like parquet. Rap dogs off, so strong, Jay. I'm a little bit of pop for the Kanye. You a little bit of Fox and Beyonce. Any beef gonna be get sauteed. Yeah, the fake ones running with a hard face. Bet that pump to your tongue, make your heart race. And I hope you take it on the wrong way. Do you slump near the bum near the bar place? This red light put your in a dark place. You trip.
Yeah, I know. Hey, I got a jam now. Commercial over. See ya.
Uh-oh. Tom's missing in action. Welcome. We're back.
Are we live?
We're live.
It's ours. It's our show. We always wanted this show.
It's now enough already with Tom.
Now
we've been carrying his ass for 5 weeks.
We can tell all the off-color jokes we want.
I know we own it. I hope he's all right. I mean...
Hey, so is this coming up Tuesday? Is that when you're playing?
Yes, I believe July 5th. I don't know about playing. We'll see. I got cut, so I'm flying out there. We'll see what goes on. Hopefully, I get picked up off of waivers. But I will be in Montana for sure.
Just don't let a fastball go by. If you see a fastball, swing at it.
That's how I feel. I mean, I don't know if I'm going to get in that bad. I might have jumped the gun, but I feel like I might be able to get a piece of one. I mean, Tom Selleck filed some off. Billy Crystal got a piece of one, and he was like 80.
He was 80. Well, I don't know. I'm not sure. Oh, there we go.
Oh, his footage of Billy Crystal. Wow, how about this? I think he was 60. Look at that, elbow's down. I get my elbow up.
Yeah, this was a spring. Was it, this was in spring training, right? He played?
Yeah.
Yeah. We did that with Garth Brooks with the Angels.
Oh, did he have any skills?
He liked baseball. It stops there.
Yeah, all right. Because, I mean, I played I was a pretty successful baseball player. I think you guys are going to be surprised when you see this swing I got.
Surprised in what way?
We just want to have fun.
I mean, BP, you'll be impressed. Get in action, I think.
Hey, now you got, before we get to all that, the movie, it's called 4th of July. It's coming out this Friday, July the 1st. That's my daughter Ella's 19th birthday this coming Friday. Wow. But you did this movie with comedian Louis C.K. And it's ready to roll. Where are you going to be for it?
Yeah, so we're doing a premiere event tomorrow night, Thursday, at the Beacon Theater in New York, which is almost sold out. There's like less than 30 tickets. And it's crazy. It's like almost 2,000 people. They're going to watch it. And then Friday, we're doing an event in Boston at the Schubert Theater. Saturday at the Vic Theater in Chicago. And it opens nationally in a few theaters July 1st. It's confusing because the movie's called 4th of July. It opens on the 1st of July and it plays on the 6th of July. But July 6th, it's playing all over America and Canada at AMC theaters at 7:30 p.m. And you can go to louisck.com to find out if it's playing at a theater near you. There is one playing in Cincinnati if you're off next Wednesday.
Really? Which one? Because I really want to see it.
Yeah. Oh, geez. I have to look it up. I'm such a bad businessman. I'll find out. I'll text you.
That really is lame.
Hey, so to find the AMC theaters it's in, we could probably find it on the AMC website and the louisck.com.
LewisCK.com or Fandango. If you use the Fandango app or Fandango.com.
Okay.
If you plug it into your phone, it'll tell you the nearest one.
Okay great.
So now you've committed now to play for the Missoula Paddleheads. Are you ready to go? Are you doing any kind of training? I mean, that's coming up on Tuesday night at Flathead Field in Whitefish, Montana.
Well, the problem is this movie is consuming my life. We're doing a lot of media for it, and sure, I'm crying in the fetal position. So I haven't been able to hit any cages. And I live in New York City, and believe it or not, there's a shortage of batting cages here. There used to be one down the street from me in Astoria, and it's closed. So, but I am a guy who needs a baseball bat to think. So in my free when I'm watching the Sox or just walking around, I always am swinging a bat. I'm not kidding. I take about 35 to 50 cuts a day, and so I feel like I'm ready, and I've been stretching a lot because, you know, I'm 40 now, you know.
Yeah.
So I'm ready. But I think Yastrzemski played till he was 61 or something, and Pete Rose was 78 managing and playing. So I think I got it. Jamie Moyer was what, 46 years old?
Yeah. And he looked like it by the time he got to the end.
I love Jamie Moyer, by the way.
I did want to
take us off topic, but
I did too.
There was a moment, and I'm way off script here, but when Carl Everett was with the Red Sox, Moyer hit him, and then Everett said, "Next pitch, I'm taking you over the monster," and he did it, and Moyer tipped his cap to him, and I thought that was such a class move.
Yeah, Moyer. Moyer is like folklore stuff up there in Seattle, Billy.
Yeah, he and Everett ended up on the same team for a year. But I just saw Jamie down in San Diego a little while back. He still looks the same. He looks like he could go out and go after Joe List.
Let's get him on the show. I want to talk about this Carl Everett moment. I think about it all the time.
We should. You get him on the show, you won't have a hard time getting him to talk.
No.
I love guys like that.
Yeah, no doubt. You know, Billy Crystal, another comedian, Joe, he did this whole thing for the Yanks.
Yeah, I know, and he didn't get a base hit, and I'm gonna show him who's boss with my base hit.
Okay,
and that was big league pitching.
All right, so for next Wednesday's show, Joe is going to be playing. If you're in the Whitefish Kalispell area Tuesday night, you'll be in uniform against the Range Riders. So get out there to Flathead Field and cheer him on. Are you doing any shows, by the way, while you're out there, or are you just there to play baseball? Focused in on that.
I'm just there to play baseball. You know, once I put the uniform on, I'm not a comedian. I'm not a husband. I'm not anything. I'm just a ball player. And I think I've talked about this in my podcast. I think I got a few fans coming to the game, so I'll do my best.
That's awesome. Well, I'm excited to see you. I can't wait. I wish I could come out there for it, but we'll be dialed in and watching it for sure. Let's get to the Syracuse guys and check in and preview the games around the league that'll be getting started in about 45 minutes from now. Hayden Wasserman, Billings Mustangs, they're at the Rocky Mountain Vibes. How you doing, Hayden?
I'm doing well. My hair's being cut off, so it looks like I have a normal haircut.
Whoa. Your hair what?
My hair's being cut off, so it looks like I have like a normal haircut. It's going in and out. I'm moving around, but
you mean the graphic stuff. Mine does too, and I don't have any hair like you do, so I can't lose mine. You know, you're okay.
Yeah, I appreciate that. So today's early game was the Billings Mustangs versus the Rocky Mountain Vibes. It was Sean Kiley, who leads the league with a 1.66 ERA, versus Brett Irwin, who actually only got signed a week ago and made his second start today. And it was all Billings today. As top of the first, Jordan Hovey had a double RBI double. Top of the third, Jackson Rapper with an RBI double, Mitch Piatnik with RBI double, followed by a Cruz Taylor RBI single and a Jordan Hovey sack fly in the fourth. And then in the fifth, Jacob Klein RBI double, followed by a Jordan Barth single, which knocked him in, and Brian Pereira. So that made it a 7-0 game, I believe. And then Jacob Klein scored on a sack fly, putting the Mustangs up 10-0 in just the sixth inning. So not Brett Irwin's best start, but you know, he's improving. It's only his second start. So he ended the day with 4 innings pitched, 5 earned runs, and 4 strikeouts. And the Vibes avoided the shutout today with a Ethan Lopez home run in the bottom of the ninth. So the final score was 10-1, and Sean Kiley kept up his stellar season with 6 innings pitched, 4 hits, and a win today.
Wow. Okay. Hayden, thanks. Zach Van Arsdale covering the Idaho Falls Chuckers at the Missoula Paddleheads. How you doing, Zach?
I'm good. How are you guys?
Doing good, man. You're double duty. You're reporting on games, and you're co-producing the show tonight.
Yeah, it's an honor to be producing with you guys, so I'm happy to be here. But out in Missoula, we got a big matchup tonight. The Idaho Falls Chuckers taking on the Missoula Paddleheads. These are the top two teams in the league, respectively first and second in the North Division. Idaho Falls coming in at 18-11, with Missoula at 20-9. So first with Idaho Falls. They are on a one-game win streak, though. In their last 8, they are 2-6, including a sweep by the Missoula Paddleheads. They started the season 17-5, and that was thanks to their offensive weapons. Calvin Estrada, Brady West, and Hunter Hissey have very well helped this offense succeed. The Idaho Falls offense is first in the league in average, on base percentage, slugging, runs, and RBIs. So they have really produced well on the offense side of things. Their pitching has also pitched well. Third best ERA in the league behind Joe Slocum, Ramsey Romano, and Jack DiCenzo. So it'll be interesting to see the Idaho Falls offense tonight. But not only is the Idaho Falls offense good, the Missoula Paddleheads, they are on fire right now. They are first in North Division. They're on a 7-game win streak off back-to-back sweeps. So looking for their third sweep in a row. And this pitching staff is incredible. They're led by Jason Newman, Jared Atkins, and Lamar Sparks. And they're first in ERA, Ks per nine, and strikeouts. This team has been incredible all year. They're the defending champions. And a bright spot is Jason Newman, who I just mentioned. He's basically the Shohei Ohtani of this league. Bats, pitches, does everything. Won Player of the Week 2 weeks ago. Just an all-around incredible athlete. It's going to be, you know, really cool to watch him play tonight. But other than that, you know, just great offense against great pitching tonight. So if you are into that stuff, I would definitely tune into the Missoula Idaho Falls game. Thanks,
all right,
guys.
Zach, thanks a bunch. Yeah, Newman is a guy who's a big, heavy, strong kid that plays first base. It's a lot of home runs, great hitter, and he's the closer. So he'll come over from first base in the ninth inning and start closing out games. Matthias Altman-Kurosaki has Northern Colorado against Grand Junction. How you doing, Matthias?
Doing well. Great to see you guys again. So tonight, the 12-15 Northern Colorado Owls, led by their new manager, Robbie Bales, will face off against the 15-15 Grand Junction Rockies, led by their manager, two-time All-Star and 2005 World Series champion, Bobby Jenks. The Owls have actually lost 4 of 5. They just lost 4 of 5 to the Rocky Mountain Vibes. The Rockies have won 4 of 6, though they did just drop back-to-back games. The last time these guys faced off, they split the 6 games. So coming in, though, this pitching matchup is pretty interesting, in my opinion. We have Colton Williams making his PBL debut for the Owls against Josh Agnew for Grand Junction. And Colton Williams, man, to say that his 3-year career at the University of Sciences and Arts of Oklahoma was dominant would be an understatement. He was one of the best pitchers in NAIA history. Mm. During his 3 years, he went 33-1 with a 1.33 ERA, a .880 whip, and 264 strikeouts against just 44 walks in 217 innings. I should add in, he only allowed 4 home runs in that time. He holds the school records for wins, strikeouts, and ERA, and he also threw 14 complete games. He was also the 3-time Sooner Athletic Conference Pitcher of the Year. 2019, he was the NAIA Player of the Year, and he was also the conference's Male Athlete of the Year in 2020. He is the only NAIA pitcher ever to win the first 33 decisions of his career. Last year in 2021, he pitched for the Utica Unicorns of the United States Shore League. And he, in 5 appearances, he had a 2.57 ERA. As for Agnew, he's only 2-2 with a 5.64 ERA in 30 1/3 innings. But his last start, he pitched well. 7 innings, allowed 8 hits, 3 runs, 2 earned, no walks, and 4 strikeouts, though he was charged with a loss against Ogden. As for Noco, they are led offensively by Alex Jackson, who's the only player on their team who's appeared in every single game. He leads the team in hits and homers. And Kevin Higgins, who leads the team with a .377 batting average and 22 RBIs. And for Grand Junction, Nico Popa has been one of the best hitters in the league, hitting .397 with a .437 on base and a .565 slugging. That is 5th in the PBL in average and 2nd in hits. And then Caleb Farmer, who only has 70 at-bats, but has hit 6 homers. So this is a pretty good interstate, interdivisional rivalry, I'd say, going. You know, NoCo, bit of a new team, but this will be big because Grand Junction is in 2nd place and nipping at the heels of Ogden. So big matchup tonight in Grand Junction.
All right, Matthias, thanks. Speaking of Ogden at home tonight, the Raptors are hosting Boise. The Hawks, Austin Murphy, what's the story there, young man? How are you?
I'm good. How are you all doing?
Doing great. Thank you.
Great. Well, tonight's matchup will face the 12-18 Boise Hawks against the 16-14 Ogden Raptors. These two teams met earlier this season for a 5-game series in Boise, of which the Raptors won 4. However, the 4th-place Hawks currently sit 4 games behind their first-place opponents and will need to get the ball rolling soon if they're looking to get back into contention. But both teams will certainly have something to play for, as Ogden will be looking to cement their spot atop the division by ending a rather average June with some good wins. Both clubs, however, will have their share of weapons available, as Ogden fields the trio of Jesus Valdez, Freddy Achacar, and Reese Alexiades, who are each in the top 12 of RBIs, with Valdez and Alexiades both ranking in the top 6 for home runs. But they will be matched by Boise's own trio of Juan Teixeira, Jacob Cruz, and Tyler Dorgensen, each of whom are top 10 in doubles and boast batting averages above 240. Additionally, Teixeira ranks 10th in hits and 7th in RBIs, while Jorgensen's 4th in triples. But batting isn't the only thing these two teams have, as both clubs have level two elite level pitching in the PBL. Ogden ace Ronnie Ortiz hits first place in the league with ERA at 4.59, but Boise's Ian Kahualoa, who was player of the week last week, is right behind him at 4.75. Orta is also tied for the league in wins with 4, while Kahualoa leads the league in strikeouts with 36. So with both teams boasting powerhouse offenses and a league-leading pitching staff, this series is bound to be filled with some fireworks as both teams look to kick off the home stretch with some wins.
All right, Austin, thank you very much, young man. Owen Trainer, you're going to do double duty for us tonight. Let's start first covering the Glacier Range Riders against the Great Falls Voyagers. How you doing, Owen?
Doing good. All right, so Glacier Range Riders come in at 12-17. They lost one. They lost two of their last three against Idaho Falls. Great Falls Voyagers come in at 17-13. But they got swept their past three games in Missoula. This matchup has happened 9 times so far this year, with Great Falls being 6-3 against Glacier. Some star players for Glacier is outfielder Ben McConnell. He gets on base 43% of the time. He has 18 stolen bases in 27 games played, and he leads the team with 35 hits. On the other side, you guys might know Montana Quigley. He's 3-0 this year with a 3.06 ERA. He's got 5 saves. However, recently, he has 5 earned runs in his last 4 innings pitched. This year, he still hasn't allowed a home run, so we'll see what happens. For Glacier, they have 12 home runs in 6 games played in May, but have slowed down a lot recently. They have 16 home runs in 23 games played in June. On the other side, Great Falls has better at-bats when they're at home versus away. They have 30 games played this year, 15 at home and 15 away. At home, they have 101 strikeouts to 79 walks, while on the road, they have 166 strikeouts to 61 walks.
All right, Owen, while you're at it, bring us up to date on what's happened over the last week and the standings and players of the week. Where are we?
Yeah, that's right. So last week, we had the Grand Junction Rockies have a two knockout round victories, which actually came in the same day. And in the last 3 weeks, we've had at least one knockout round. So I would say keep your eyes peeled for another knockout round this week. We could make it 4 weeks in a row with a knockout round. Mm. For the standings, you see Missoula and Ogden at the top of each division. Missoula comes in at 20-9, and they're on a 7-game win streak. Behind them, they're also playing Idaho Falls, who comes in at 8-11. They're 3-7 in their last 10. Great Falls is 17-13, who's also 3-7 in their last 10. Billings behind them has won 3 of their last games. And Glacier is at the bottom at 12-17. They've lost 1 in a row. On the other side, Ogden is 16-14. They've won 2 in a row. Grand Junction comes in at even, 15-15. They've lost 2 in a row. Northern Colorado is just behind at 12-15. Boise, 12-18. And Rocky Mountain Vibes are 8-21. However, they have started to come back. They've won 4 of their last 5 games against Northern Colorado. And we can move to the players of the week. So our first player is the North batter of the week was Brandon Riley, a Missoula outfielder. He went 12-28. He had 2 triples and 4 doubles. The North pitcher of the week comes from Billings, the pitcher, Jean Correa. He had 7 innings pitched, only allowed 1 hit, and had no earned runs. I'm pretty sure he brought a no-hit bid into the 8th inning. On the other side in the South, our batter of the week is Charles Middleton, a Grand Junction Rockies outfielder. He went 11-29 and had 3 extra base hits this past week. And last is the South pitcher, Yohandri Perez, who's the Rocky Mountain Vibes pitcher. He went 6 2/3 innings and only allowed 1 earned run.
All right, Owen, that's great stuff, man. Appreciate it very much, and we'll check back in with you in just a little while. As we do each week, we try to focus in on one of the great PBL teams and the city in which they play. Tonight, we're going to take a look, and Bill Bavasi, you were just there. The Ogden Raptors and their wonderful ballpark they have there in Ogden, Utah. You were just out there recently.
You know, I was, and I try to go there when I can. I just love Ogden. I love the city. I love the ballpark. We were I was the farm director for the Dodgers in 2002 and 2003. And in 2003, we moved our affiliation from Great Falls, another great spot, to Ogden. It was just a more convenient thing for our scouting department, all our folks in LA to be able to take a 45-minute flight over there. But you know, convenience aside, it's just a great franchise. You know, Dave Baggett does a great job with it. It's a great ballpark, Lindquist Field. Mm-hmm. It's a great place to watch a game. And I say this all the time: if you're within a couple hours of Ogden, get up to a ball game.
Yeah, it looks gorgeous. It's one of these stadiums with the big mountains out there in center field, right? And is it right that there's a Mormon temple out there?
There is, in center field, right? And heaven. So I suppose I should mention about Dave Baggett, when they were remodeling the temple there, he had lobbied for the statue of the angel Moroni to be turned so that it would face the ballpark right there, so that Moroni could watch ball games. I think there's other priorities with the LDS Church. They didn't make the change for him.
Well, that's fair. They tried. I mean, that is just gorgeous. I got to get out there. I had to look up Ogden, and then someone told me there's a comedy club there also. Can you confirm that, or are they messing with me to try to get me to go there?
Wise Guys.
I got to get to Wise Guys. I've done Wise Guys in Salt Lake City, but never Ogden.
I think it's a Wise Guys there, but it's a lot of good bars and restaurants there in that little downtown. I mean, it's not a big metropolis. It's just a real cool place.
Yeah, and in fact, Joe, as a kicker to all this, apparently Bags, the owner, he used to have his grounds crew in dresses, and they called them the drag queens.
That's my idea.
Your idea?
Yeah, that was in 2003.
You were a man ahead of your time. Now you just go to your local library.
No, now I would get canceled. So we were Bags and I were having lunch. I said, "Hey, why don't you know these guys you have there? It's a motley looking crew. You ought to just throw them in dresses and don't be too careful with it." And so, sure enough, man, if you went to a ball game, you saw these guys and they were pissed. They didn't like it, so they would put these things on, and the dresses weren't really on. The wigs weren't really on, but right. The cigarettes were, and it just looked so good. There were shorts, boots, and these dresses, and they walked around just teed off. It was way better than the Yankees YMCA. Way better.
Hey, you're a pioneer in many ways, Bill Bavasi. Who would have known? Who would have known? All right, let's find out more about the ballpark, more about the Ogden Raptors and the city of Ogden from the Raptors general manager, Trevor Wilson. Trevor, welcome to the PBL Roundup show. Where are you sitting right now? You look like you're in a pretty sweet spot.
Yeah, I'm actually over on our first base side of the ballpark in the O-Town Beach Club.
Tell us about that spot.
So it's great. It's brand new. We've only had it for 2 years now here in the park, and it's a full-service bar. So you want your margarita, your shots, whatever. Freak, right now I'm just getting my dinner tonight. and it's full-service kind of kitchen. You want salmon, you want steak, you want shrimp, you want a burger, you want your nacho. They've got it all.
Billy?
Yeah, Tom, last year I had the great good fortune to get to O-Town Beach Club not long after it opened. I was with Mike Shapiro and his family. And all those things you mentioned, Trevor, we ate all that. And it's all good. It's all good stuff. It's a full kitchen. It's really, really a good spot to watch a ball game. I think you have netting up there, right? So you're not gonna get killed. So it's a great spot to relax and watch a ball game. There's a spot I think just beyond there for kids to play. It's safe there too. It's just a great ballpark, and that's the best piece of the ballpark that Trevor's sitting in front of right now.
Trevor, I want to talk to you a little bit about, your background. How did you become the general manager of the Ogden Raptors?
Fun story. I have started from the bottom up here in the park. I started younger as a youth, just working concession stands, pouring sodas.
Really?
That's all I did that one summer was pour sodas. And then it was like right time, right place on all of my little advancements throughout the hierarchy of baseball, moving up to being concession, more concessions leads, concessions runners, found my opportunity to work in the front office doing selling tickets, became the box office manager. And then after going through school and getting some graduations under my belt, a little more real world experience, they brought me into my current role.
Boy, that is cool. That is really cool. Congratulations to you. So you're an Ogden native.
I am an Ogden native, born and raised. The only time I've really spent outside of Ogden was in grad school in Detroit, Michigan.
Wow. How about that?
Hey, so we have a question we have to ask you. I may have given the wrong answer. Is Wise Guys a comedy club in Ogden?
Oh, I can't remember what the name of it is, but we are still – there is a comedy club and a lot of other bars on Historic 25th.
Yeah.
And someone sent me some of this this history that there used to be bootleggers hanging out there and brothels. And this is in Utah. Oh, yeah. There's a brothel pass, because I've been to Utah and I couldn't find the brothel. I looked all over.
Oh, yeah. Ogden's changed quite a bit over the years. But, yeah, back in, I think, the 1920s, there's a lot of stories about Al Capone visiting Ogden, and that Ogden was way too rough for Al Capone. He stayed. Some say he walked the street from the train station and walked straight back and got on the next train. Others say he hid out in Ogden for about 3 months in the brothels, the underground tunnels, jumping from bar to bar, hotel to hotel, and then was like, all right, this is too much. I got to get out of here.
Wow. He looks like Jose Rio in that photo. By the way, I haven't got my box of cigars from Jose Rio, by the way.
I haven't either.
I'm waiting on my
him back.
Sorry, but no, I did Wise Guys in Salt Lake City, and I'm going to go back and try to schedule it around an Ogden game, because this looks just fantastic. And if I go there, Trevor, can I throw out the first pitch or umpire or do something fun?
Oh, we can definitely set something up for you.
Hell
we
yeah.
We got a couple on-field contests we could definitely throw you into, too.
Okay.
You know, hey, Trevor, what you guys have all kinds of great stuff going on for the fans and promotions and all that kind of stuff. Tell us what you have in store the rest of this year. We had heard something earlier about you doing a tribute to the great movie A League of Their Own.
That's correct. The League of Their Own has the 30th anniversary of the premiere this year. Actually, this week. I guess it was premiered on July 1st, 30 years ago. And so in conjunction with that, Dave was told, hey, let's show the movie. And Dave's like, let me do one better. Let's do an actual women's baseball game. And so, lo and behold, a bunch of things later, this Saturday, July 2nd, we have a League of Their Own. We've got two teams, and they're going to go head-to-head and play a seven-inning baseball game. And so that's a big promotion. The biggest thing we're doing with this is not only is it going to be a women's baseball game, but we're using this to help raise funds for suicide prevention. So their first
fantastic
game on July 2nd, yeah, we'll be partnering with the Hope Squads here in Ogden for July 2nd, and then their second game they play on July 11th, we'll be partnering with Live On, which is a statewide initiative for all ages.
That is fantastic. Oh, that's great stuff. And you guys are having a good year.
Yeah. Starting off strong. We've already had quite a few fans and seats and holding firm with that lead of large attendance.
That is fantastic. Trevor, thank you for your time tonight. I know you're getting ready for first pitch here in just a few minutes. So thanks so much for your time and all the best. And we can't wait to get out there and see you.
Perfect. Can't wait to have you guys out.
All right, Trevor. Thanks so much. Yeah, Billy, I know you love that place. And you're good friends with the owner. We had him on a couple of weeks ago. Seems like a great dude.
Yeah, real good guy. Real inventive. He's been doing independent baseball for a long time. He had a stretch of affiliated with baseball with Milwaukee and the Dodgers, but he's no stranger to independent baseball. He's always staying one step ahead. I love the work he does.
Joe, you know, that's where that movie, There's No Crying in Baseball, that's where that line came from.
Yeah, I love A League of Their Own. It just made me feel good that our movie is premiering 30 years to the day from A League of Their Own's debut. And I always had one beef with the League of Their Own. Remember at the beginning, they're all at the tryouts, and I think it Rosie O'Donnell, she whips the baseball at Gina Davis, and Gina Davis catches it with her bare hand, and it's a moment they become friends. But it's actually quite psychotic that Rosie O'Donnell's character was going to whip a baseball at someone's face.
Well, it's Rosie O'Donnell.
I don't know when the last time you saw. I'm kind of like Rain Man with movies. I really I remember them, but. But it's a great movie, and I love it. And Avoid the Clap, Jimmy Dugan, the best line in any baseball movie.
Yeah.
Here are some of the play. I mean, you talk about some stallions now.
Pretty players
through there. Look at these guys.
Wow.
Including Tommy Lasorda as a manager there in Ogden. The great Frank Robinson when he was coming up with the Reds. Most of these guys, obviously, former Dodgers in that affiliation for so long. That's great stuff.
Yeah, that picture of Tommy there with looks like Buckner, Garvey, and Valentine. You know, they had good teams there, and Tommy did stuff as a manager back then that, you know, you wouldn't see today. They had a lot of good players, and so he knew he had a bunch of players not getting at bats, not getting in innings, not getting a chance. This guy would go in for a three-game series, four-game series, and at least twice he would talk the other manager into playing a 1 o'clock game or a noon game for the kids who hadn't been playing much. And so I always looked at everything Tommy did in Ogden, because he was a scout at that time. So he would scout in Southern California and then go to Ogden in the summer and manage. But he got it. He just got player development. And he really, I always really looked up to that, what he did with those guys, because I never saw it done by anybody else. And I it's not a big deal, but
no, that's a great story.
You're right. One of those kids who don't play, you know, it does matter.
Well, we've talked about before. I mean, you know, I could sit around and talk for days about Tommy Lasorda. And when I was a 24-year-old broadcaster in the big leagues and just going to his office, it was showtime every single day. And it was the best part of my day every time you knew you were going to play the Dodgers. Let's take a further look into this year's Raptors team. Billy, I know you had a chance to visit with their first-year pitching coach. I can't believe this guy's a pitching coach there, because when I was doing the Cubs games in the early 90s, he was just coming up to the big leagues, Les Lancaster. And Bill and Les got together earlier today. Check it out.
We're lucky enough to have Ogden pitching coach Les Lancaster with us, and Les has had a heck of a time in the big leagues, great big league career. And the Ogden Raptors are really lucky to have this guy teaching their pitchers there. So I'm just going to get into it, if it's okay, Les.
Yeah, go right ahead.
Thanks for being here, man. So you had a seven-year career. You made 39 starts. Is there one start in particular that was your favorite, or a game that made you believe, hey, I belong here, or any start or two that has any special remembrance for you?
Well, definitely my very first start. I started the season out in 87 as a non-roster invitee to spring training, then kind of shocked everybody that I made opening day roster. And, you know, I was out of the bullpen at the time. Then they sent me down to AAA to Des Moines to get some work in to build up my pitch count, then brought me back up, and I had my first start against the Mets at Shea Stadium. Yeah, so pretty good place to have the first one. Did very well, pitched seven innings, gave up one run, no decision.
That's a heck of a start for a young guy coming in.
Yeah, I was, you know, especially with the team they had at that time and all that. Yeah. And, it was just a great experience. And that kind of made me have the belief that, hey, against this team, I did what I did, I belong here.
Yeah. Who was your manager?
At that time, it was Gene Michaels.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Old stick.
Yeah. Great guy.
Yeah. Really good guy. Great guy.
Real smart baseball guy. So, you know, you're drafted in the 24th round by the Yankees in 81. 2 years later, you're drafted by the Rangers in the 39th round, but you ended up signing as an undrafted free agent. That can get kind of complicated to our fans. How'd that work for a young guy going through that?
Well, I was drafted out of high school by the Yankees, and I've already committed to Arkansas, so I went to Arkansas. I was drafted by the Texas Rangers while I was still there. And, you know, we just couldn't agree upon a deal and everything, so I stayed in. And then my junior, senior year of college, I did not get drafted. Mm-hmm. So, of course, I'm thinking, man, did I mess up? And then the Cubs scout that saw me during high school asked me when I was going to pitch during the summer. He came and saw me. So we'll give you $1,000, go to rookie ball. Year and a half later, I'm in the big leagues.
Yeah. A year and a half. I didn't realize it was that quick. But you know, you based on your background, you're like you might be the perfect pitching coach, manager, coach in an independent league like the Pioneer League. So that's great for them. Like I said earlier, you know, Ogden's really lucky to have you. So after you've played for several seasons in the major leagues, you became a manager for independent teams. You managed in the Northern League with the Adirondack Lumberjacks and the Lincoln Salt Dogs, as well as the Reno Silver Sox in the Golden Baseball League. You skippered the Sioux City Explorers. Which of these spots was your favorite spot and why? And we're going to exclude Ogden because we know you love Ogden, but let's exclude that for now.
I'd have to say it's either be Lincoln or Reno. Mm-hmm. And everything. Actually, when I went into Lincoln, Cash was the manager. I just went as a pitcher and everything. And then I ended up taking over as manager and everything. And that's probably the last year I quit pitching. So, you know, it was a brand new facility at the University of Nebraska baseball mm-hmm. field.
Yeah.
And the owners and all that, the Jim Abels and the Charlie Myers and everything were great people to work for. And then the Golden Baseball League came about, which was a very good league. All the managers had big league experience.
Yeah.
It was myself, Gary Templeton, Darrell Evans, Mark Parent.
Yeah.
So, you know, Terry Kennedy, all of us was around and everything. And it went well. And I loved it out there, the cities and everything that we played in.
That's great. That's a great group of folks. I was with Gary Templeton. I think I might have been the GM in Anaheim or the farm director. We had him on our staff. Real good guy to work with. Really good guy.
Yeah. I love Tempe. Tempe's awesome.
Yeah. So now you've done both. You know, you've managed clubs in independent baseball. You've been a pitching coach. You prefer one over the other?
I mean, I like managing. I do. I really like managing a lot and everything because I kind of see it from a pitcher's perspective, a little bit different and everything. So when I was a manager and I talked to the hitters, you know, I'm talking to them from a pitcher, what I'm seeing as a pitcher and everything. And so here with Cash being a hitting guy, you know, they get double barrel of it.
Yeah. Yeah, they do. So in your stint post major league career, you've won two league championships as a manager, one with Adirondack and one with Reno. Do you favor one over the other? That's a hard question. But if not, were there any special thoughts or remembrances about those experiences?
It is. I mean, definitely the first one, you know, is definitely something that will always be with me and everything. You know, we didn't have a real big high power offense, but we had pitching and defense, and that's what won the championship for us. And, you know, Reno, we were pretty loaded all the way around there with offense and the ball flying out in there and Reno and everything. But we had a real good team that just put up great numbers all the way around.
Yeah. You know, I think you're real unique in what you've done. I think you're similar to a lot of guys who just love the game, just love the game of baseball. And I think there's a purity to it in the independent leagues, you know, because it's not just about development. You know, you're always doing your best to develop kids, but you're trying to win some games. And you know, it's kind of left up to you. It's, you know, you're not given anything from an organization. When you see a guy that you think is a prospect, you know, you get to work with him, and you're going to get him back to a major league organization. But you've done that. You know, you finished playing at the major league level, at the highest level, and in big series, big postseason deals. And then you went and played a couple of years or a few years in independent baseball.
Right.
So I'm going to ask you two questions. One is does that give you, and I think the answer is yes, but does that give you a special reference point for the young pitchers and position players that you're associating yourself with now?
I think so. I think it really does. I think my background and everything since, you know, where I've accomplished as a player and everything, and and then playing independent myself, being a pitching coach and independent ball manager, seeing all that, that I have a pretty good grasp on it. You know, my job is to make the pitchers better and everything else win, and hopefully get them a chance to with an organization, first chance, second chance, whatever it may be,
yeah,
and give them the opportunity maybe to refine themselves and take advantage of it.
Yeah. Well, that's great. Listen, man, we're going to wrap it up here, but you know, like I said, the Ogden folks know they're lucky to have you there. Those kids, half of them do know that they're lucky to have you there, and half of them are going to know. You know, I know how this goes, and they're going to understand it, and they're going to really appreciate it. And we at the PBL Roundup show really appreciate you taking the time. Time is something we know you don't have anything of, because those staffs are small. You're doing everything. Really appreciate your time, man.
No, I appreciate having me and everything, and I enjoy myself here.
Great. Good luck the rest of the year. Thanks.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
All right. Take care.
All right. Bye.
You know, it's funny, Billy, I was there with the Cubs, and, you know, you talked about he came up in 87, and then I really felt like he got jerked around by them when I was there. And what I mean by that is, you know, in 89, this is when Greg Maddux is emerging, a guy most people don't remember but had an incredible year, a guy named Mike Bielecki as a starting pitcher, but they were really thin down in the bullpen. And so they moved Lancaster from a starter, and he eventually became primarily the rest of his career a relief pitcher. But it always seemed like when they would spot start him, that was a role he felt a lot more comfortable in. I think he could have been a really solid major league starting pitcher had they left him in that role.
Yeah, you know, I'm going to go with that, Tommy, because I don't remember him that well.
Yeah, it was an interesting group. A really interesting group. They had some, you know, that was a great series they had against the Giants in 89. Don Zimmer came over, eventually became the manager there with Les Lancaster in that group. But a good guy, and his Raptors are in first place in the PBL Southern Division. Yeah. And speaking of their team, we'll give you a little more in-depth. Austin Murphy, understand you've done a little digging around about this Raptors club this year.
Yeah, they're off to a pretty great start so far, which is something they like to maintain as we approach the end of the first half. Coming into tonight, they come in at 16-14, which is good for first in the South Division. However, they can't sit too comfortable up there, as their lead over the second place Grand Junction Rockies sits at just one game. This tight race is in part due to some bumps in the road, as Ogden has had recently. They've gone only 5-5 in their last 10, including a 13-12 record in June. Even though they started off the month 6-1, they've gone 7-11 since, watching their division lead shrink along with it. However, all is not lost for Ogden, and they will have plenty of chances to secure their spot at the top of the division over the last 18 games of the first half. The remaining games include a 3-game set against Boise, which begins tonight, another 3 games against Idaho Falls this weekend, and then 2 6-game series against Northern Colorado and Rocky Mountain to close out the half. Of those opponents, only Idaho Falls has a better record, and each except for the Chuckers are within the same division as Ogden, meaning for the Raptors to finish on top of the division, they will have to show why they are the best team in the South. As for the players who have gotten them to this point, the Raptors have received massive contributions from infielder Jesus Valdez. The Week 4 South Division Batter of the Week has raked so far this season, going .396 from the plate with 8 home runs and 30 RBIs in 30 games played. Those numbers are good enough to place him 6th in the league in batting average, 3rd in home runs, and 8th in RBIs. Also chipping in is the Week 1 Division Batter of the Week, Freddy Achikar, and outfielder Reeks Alexiades. Achikar is hitting .264 with 4 home runs and 27 RBIs, while Alexiades has 6 home runs to go with 27 RBIs while batting .273. Their 27 RBIs places both players tied for 12th in the league for RBIs, while Alexiades' 6 home runs are enough to tie him for 6th. As the first half winds down, it's going to be these players who Ogden has to rely on to carry them home on top.
Great stuff, Austin. Appreciate you filling us in more along the line of how that Ogden team is doing so far this year. And you mentioned sitting atop their division. Austin, great stuff. The Pioneer League's director of baseball operations is a young man we introduced you to. You saw him a lot last year in and around the league as a player and now an administrator, Aaron Bond. He had a chance to catch up with former Ogden shortstop, Fox Simonis, who, by the way, the Raptors selected out of their Pioneer League tryout camp this past April. What's great about this is not only does Fox get drafted in the tryout camp, he makes the Raptors team. And then about 2 weeks ago, he gets signed by the Arizona Diamondbacks and assigned to their high A affiliate in Hillsboro, Oregon. And Billy, we talk about it all the time. That's the goal of these players.
Yeah. I think that's one thing we have going for us with the Pioneer League are these tryout series and you know, giving kids a chance to get to these tryouts and be seen. And so Fox doesn't go anywhere if he doesn't get to a tryout, you know, or I guess he could become a comedian and then get a one day tryout. But those camps, I think we've got it so that I think the PBL runs those camps where they sign two players out of every camp, I believe. Each team.
Yes. Yeah. Two. Well. Yes. We either to play this year or a guarantee to be next year.
Yeah, and nobody's doing that. So this is getting, you know you're going to go to a tryout where a bunch of kids are going to get signed. So I just, you know, I think the world of these tryouts, and I know they're not that easy for everybody to get to, whether, you know, for a lot of different reasons, but if you can do it, get to them.
All right, let's check out the interview. Aaron Bond, take it away, young man.
What's up, man?
What's up? How you doing?
Good, man. So where are you at right now?
I'm currently in Hillsboro in Oregon with the Diamondbacks.
That's their high A, right?
Mm-hmm.
Dope, man. How long have you been out there?
I've been out here for a week and a half now.
I see you having a strong start to the season, hitting, I think, 315, if I remember looking right?
Yeah, something like that. I haven't checked too much on the stats yet. Just looking at videos mainly.
Okay. So, man, let's just hop right into it, man. So, first thing is, man, What inspired you to pursue a career in professional baseball?
I mean, I grew up playing baseball whole life. You know, watched my dad play on the men's softball leagues. We show up at the, I think it used to be the AAA stadium for the Nats, the PNAT stadium. He would always, we'd go watch those games and watch him play. So always grew up watching baseball, being a big fan of baseball. So being able to do it as a job is one of the things I've always been itching to do.
Dude, that's dope. I can honestly relate to that story because my dad played men's softball growing up, and like I think he played like twice a week, and I was his playing catch partner for like every game. And mm-hmm. like for me, I was the same way. Like it just got me into baseball. Like I was always at a baseball field if I could try to be.
Yeah, I feel like we grew up around baseball fields, always playing.
Yeah. Did you play any other sports growing up?
We used to swim and other stuff when I was little. I mean, rec basketball here and there, but I think I used to play hockey when I was like 7. I had to choose between travel hockey and travel baseball because they're both getting a little expensive, and I chose baseball.
Looks like you made the right choice.
Yeah.
So what is it like moving from the PBL to the Diamondbacks organization?
It's pretty cool. There's a lot of stuff you get everything's really more planned out, I feel like. There's a lot more, I feel like, routines set into motion for you and a lot of more emphasis on you developing as an individual coming up here.
Sidetrack. When you were in Ogden, did you get a chance to go to the in a jelly jar? Like that little cafe that's around the
corner? I don't think I did.
Dang, that's some of the best breakfast I ever had, like best chicken and waffles. Yeah, though.
What's it called again?
I think Pig in a Jelly Jar.
No, we didn't go to that one. I think I went to Waffle Love once, though.
Waffle Love one? Heard that's pretty good. What is your favorite ballpark food? That was actually
I'd say probably just. I'd say probably just hot dogs, man. I love hot dogs at the ballpark.
You cannot never turn down a good hot dog.
Yeah.
Are you just eating it dry? You putting like, what do you got? Ketchup, relish? What do you got on it?
Definitely just straight ketchup mustard on it, and they go down pretty quick.
That's good, man. Yeah. So I got to ask about the tryout because, like, people don't know you were actually at our tryout in April in Tucson. And you were one of our first one of the first round picks to Ogden. And people would like to know, man, how, like, what was the tryout like when you were there? Like, how was it for you? What was your experience like?
Personally, it was a lot of fun just to be back on a field again, because I hadn't been on a baseball field in a while after getting hurt the last season at JMU. But I mean, there's a lot of people out there. It's a lot of fun to just go around and be able to just have some fun and meet a lot of new people. I mean, it was a good experience for me. I met a lot of coaches too, who knew some of my older high school coaches and stuff too. And it's just really cool to see how baseball really connects people.
Baseball is a small world, man. You always meet somebody that knows somebody. Mm-hmm. So people also don't know about when you're at the tryout. You actually ran the fastest 60 time. Was it a 6.2 or a 6.3?
I think I ran a 6.3. I think someone else ran a 6.2. I don't know, but I think I ran a 6.3.
From my knowledge of that, I'm pretty sure I clocked it. You ran a 6, either a high 6.2 or it was like a low 6.3. And like it was fastest in the camp by like a long shot. I do remember I was the umpire on your field the second day we scrimmaged. I was the umpire on your field. And I think first day, you let out the game with a triple, a leadoff mm-hmm. triple. Was that right?
Yeah.
I think I struck you out though eventually that day, didn't I?
You're throwing the BP. I don't think you struck me out, but you definitely got me out.
Tough umpire, man.
With the upcoming tryout in Boise, would there be any advice you would give any current player that is looking to get signed by a PBL team or looking to get signed out of the PBL? Is there any advice that you would give them to help them achieve what you achieved?
I'd say it really starts with how you prepare and come into it. You got to be looking a lot further ahead than what you want to or what you're showing up for. If you want to make one of those teams, you normally want to have a bigger dream than just getting there in general. And you want to make sure you're planning and preparing for it too. You know, go out and make sure you're having fun too, though. But it is a job, so you got to treat it like one.
Good. Thank you, man. I really do appreciate the time today, man. That's all the questions I have for you today, man. I really do appreciate the time. Man, keep killing it. Keep doing what you're doing.
All right. Thank you.
That's a great story. Good for him. I mean, good for him. All of a sudden, now he's in the D-backs organization, and you never know what's up next.
No, it's great. And a 6'3", that's, you know, a 6'3", 60, that makes scouts wonder, did you have a long enough tape? Was it 60 yards?
Yeah.
So he's doing good things, you know. And like I said, Henry Hunter corrected me. We signed 20 players out of these tryout camps. 20 players, that's a lot for any kind of tryout camp.
And you saw it's July the 30th and July the 31st. That will be in Boise, Idaho. So, hey, look, you know, if you're somebody sitting at home or you know somebody, maybe a next door neighbor, whatever, whose kid was playing and all of a sudden he's not playing, he, you know, got cut loose by somebody, maybe got hurt his senior year of high school or senior year of college or whatever, let him know. You never know. That's what dreams are made of. Joe, I think there was once a song. That's the stuff that dreams are made of.
Yeah, there's a lot of dream songs. Cranberries had Dreams, and then there was New York, Where Dreams Are Made, and I Dream a Genie was a show. It was kind of hot. Was that the hot one?
She was hot.
Yeah, there was really one with hot. The bikini thing. Yeah, yeah. That was fun.
What was her name? I can't remember.
Barbara Eden. Come on.
Barbara Eden. Yeah, boy, she was hot. She's probably still hot. All right, let's check out our Roundup Show commentator, the great Will Durst, with this week's segment of Who's on Durst.
Hey guys, Will Durst here for the Pioneer Baseball League Network Roundup. And today I have a few choice words about how baseball terms have kind of infiltrated the vocabulary of real life. You know what I'm talking about. A grand slam, shutout. He's up to bat. He's on deck. And then there's the DL. He's on the DL, which we don't use anymore because disabled list. You can't use disabled as an adjective. So they turned it into the injury list, the IL. So the DL is now the IL. there's a lot more terms, but that's something that's going to happen, you know, when you've been following baseball and it's been around for 150 years. Okay, so that's it for this week. And I hope you considered my little spiel here, if not a grand slam, at least a clean double off the wall. I know I didn't hit it out of the park, but I didn't strike out either. And even if I did, I went down swinging. For the Pioneer Baseball League Network Roundup, I'm Will Durst, and we'll see you next week. In the meantime, happy baseball, everybody.
All right, Will, thank you very much. We're going to take a break and check in one more time as our games are underway, about a couple of minutes in around the league, and we'll check it out right after this.
Nation. We have a new cap lineup this year. As you know, we've started with our new red cap that we showed you a couple weeks ago. Well, today we would like to introduce another new cap. This cap here is in our tribute to an Atlanta Braves throwback uniform. Along with this new cap, we are doing a full new uniform. More details on that to come. But for now, get your new caps at OgdenRaptors.com.
Okay, good. Oh my gosh. I love it. Oh my god.
Oh. Look at that. This is the best.
Oh, this is the best.
Usually they're like really scary.
Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me. Cause I want you and I need you. And I'm down for you always, KB. Do you love me? Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me. Cause I want you and I need you. And I'm down for you always.
But the new me is really still the real me. I swear you gotta feel me before they try and kill me. They gotta make some choices. They running out of options cause I've been going all.
All righty, welcome back to the PBL Roundup alongside Joe List and Bill Bavasi. I'm Thom Brennaman. Let's get right to it before we get out of here tonight, fellas, and check in on the games. Let's start with Zach Van Arsdale, Idaho Falls at Missoula. Zach, what's happening, buddy?
So, game is about to get underway in exactly 1 minute. Again, two great powerhouse teams, a team with great offensive power, and then a team with great pitching. It'll be a great battle. Definitely tune in. We've had a lot of player or previous player of the weeks that will be playing in this week or in this game tonight. So something to look forward to. Thanks, guys.
How's that baseball team of yours doing, Zach?
Actually, they won tonight. So I'm happy about that. We play this weekend. We've been having a good season. We go to Boston next week for a week long tournament. So
all right.
It's been
all
a good summer, but yeah.
Good. All right, buddy. Good luck. Good luck.
Thank
Mathias,
you.
On the Northern Colorado at Grand Junction.
Hi, so the Grand Junction and Northern Colorado game actually kicked off at 8:35. So in the bottom of the first, Nico Popa, I said to look out for him. Well, he hit a solo home run to right center field, his fourth of the year, off of Colton Williams. So he had the second batter Colton Williams faced in his PBL career, took him deep. But he also recorded his first PBL strikeout in the next inning, striking out Sean Ross and our reigning South batter of the week, Charles Middleton. So right now, bottom two, 1-0 Grand Junction.
All right, Matthias, thank you very much. Boise is taking on Ogden. We talked a lot about Ogden tonight. Austin Murphy, you've been busy tonight. What's going on there, buddy?
Well, we're just getting underway, and Ogden first pitch just went out. But we do have our pitching duel set. It'll be Boise's left-handed Gavin Gorrell facing off against Ogden's righty Samuel Burton. Gorrell's making his third start of the season tonight. So far, he's 1-1 with 17 innings pitched and 19 strikeouts. They go with a 3.18 ERA, not too bad. Burton's making his Ogden and I think PBL debut tonight, so good luck to him. We have some interesting stats, though. Boise, for all the pitching prowess they've had this season, actually enters tonight dead last in almost every major hitting category. Home runs, RBIs, batting average, on-base percentage, and slugging, they are at the bottom. However, they're pitching, like I said, way up there, and much better than Ogden's, too. It'll be interesting to see how the pitching staff handles this series, and it's going to be the key to unlocking some wins for Boise this weekend.
All right, Austin, thanks much. And last but certainly not least, Owen Trainer, you've got the Glacier Range Riders at Great Falls.
Yeah, and as you can see on the screen right now, Glacier actually took a 1-0 lead. They had Ryan Cash, who hit a solo home run, to lead off the game, I'm pretty sure. So go ahead and check that out.
That's cool. Well, that's a good looking, looks like a beautiful night there. All right, fellas, thank you very much for all your hard work. Joe, where are you bouncing around to? Well, you talked about this is all about not stand up this week. It's all about your movie, right?
Yeah, I'm off for a couple weeks, but yeah, we got the big movie events tomorrow night, Beacon Theater in New York City, Friday, Schubert Theater in Boston, Saturday, Vic Theater in Chicago, and then Sunday, I'm going to the Red Sox at Cubs to celebrate it all.
Wow.
Nothing better than that, am I right?
That is, boy, you're going to have a great time. I hope you have a great weather day. That's cool. And then you make your professional debut in baseball on Tuesday night.
I'm off to Montana, and I'm really thrilled to have a movie come out and suit up in a professional baseball game is really unbelievable. It's a real pinch me moment, and hopefully someone pinches me. And, I'm looking forward to it. I can't wait.
Well, we're looking forward to all of it. And the movie just looks fantastic. So good luck. Stay healthy on that. Billy, what do you got going on this weekend? Big 4th of July weekend, buddy.
4th of July weekend. That's about it. That's about it. Going to watch a little baseball. And
what?
And relax. Well, not a lot. Honest to God, not a lot. I don't watch much.
No, I mean, you don't watch any like shows on Prime or Netflix or anything.
Oh
like
yeah,
that?
Oh yeah, yeah. I just got into the TV series of Fargo.
Oh yeah,
that's nuts.
Yeah, yeah. I'm in the middle of watching.
I'm binging that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I've been holding off finishing. You guys have both watched Ozark, right?
Oh God, yeah,
yeah,
yeah. I've been holding off for this last season. I don't want it to. Is there another season, or is four it?
That's it, I think. I also want to say that I took Joe's advice and I went on Fandango, so I've got a Fandango alert that's gonna alert me when there are show times within my zip code or
good. Good. I'll do the same thing. Thank you for sharing that.
Oh, yeah.
All right, fellas. Joe, Billy, great being with you. We thank Adam Jones for joining us tonight. We thank all the guys from Syracuse. We thank Mike Shapiro, Jackson Shapiro, Henry Hunter, and company. I'm Thom Brennaman. Again, 5 o'clock Mountain, 7 o'clock Eastern, each and every Wednesday night, the PBL Roundup. And until next week, everybody, happy 4th of July. Greatest country in the world, the United States of America. See you next week.
Darling, I still hear your name through the windshield wipers and the driving rain. I'll be across the Rocky Mountains in the morning. It's one too many lonely nights when the highway comes to be a way of life. Seems like about the time I'm getting there, I'm going. Hear the Peter Bell whine, down the solid white line. Don't make no money.